is actually on the beginning of Lent, where we have our typical Ash Wednesday service. Well, not typical since we haven't had one in 2 years, but we're having one this year. It will go back to our routines with communion and the imposition of ashes. This year we are sharing our sanctuary with Heritage Presbyterian Church. They will be with us and we will be meeting here in the sanctuary. It's Wednesday communion. It should only be 40, 45 minutes. We'd love for you to come and kick off Lent with us this week. If you have been visiting and would like to join, we would love for you to be members of the church. There is a new members class next Sunday. All you have to do is stay at the church, meet with me, and you can become a member. Dr. Sarah is still doing our grief support group, and they meet on March the 4th on Zoom. And the Gifts of Women's Sunday, this is an actual national day, a national Sunday in the Presbyterian Church. It is officially March 6th. We will be observing it on March 13th, and Reverend Stacy has asked if any women who would like to participate, musically, liturgy, worship leader, to please let her or the church office know, and we would like you to be part of that service. And now, let us worship.
Thank you.
Christ is the greatness of his mercy, his hope, his forgiveness, and love. Friends here, believe the good news of the gospel.
Jesus Christ, we are forgiven.
Thank you. Let us pray. O God, thank you for the gift of your word. May it enlighten us this day. May it direct us in what to do, and please, God, give us the courage and strength of character to do it. Amen. Today's scripture reading is from Psalm 99. The Lord is King. Let the people tremble. He sits enthroned upon the cherubim. Let the earth quake. The Lord is great in Zion. He is exalted over all the peoples. Let them praise your great and awesome name. Holy is he, mighty King, lover of justice. You have established equity. You have executed justice and righteousness in Jacob. Extol the Lord our God. Worship at his footstool. Holy is he. Moses and Aaron were among his priests. Samuel also was among those who called on his name. They cried to the Lord, and he answered them. He spoke to them in the pillar of cloud. They kept his decrees and the statutes that he gave them. O Lord our God, you answered them. You were a forgiving God to them, but an avenger of their wrongdoings. Extol the Lord our God, and worship at his holy mountain, for the Lord our God is holy. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you. Gracious God, we bring our gifts to you humbly and faithfully. We ask that you take what we give and help us to serve and love your people here in this community and around the world. In your name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Matthew chapter 8, verses 5 through 13. When he entered Capernaum, a centurion came to him, appealing to him, and said, Lord, my servant is lying at home paralyzed in terrible distress. And he said to him, I will come and cure him. The centurion answered, Lord, I am not worthy to have you come under my roof, but only speak the word, and my servant will be healed. For I am also a man under authority with soldiers under me. And I say to one, go, and he goes. And to another, come, and he comes. And to my slave, do this, and the slave does it. When Jesus heard him, he was amazed and said to those who followed him, truly, I tell you, in no one in Israel have I found such faith. I tell you, many will come from east and west and will eat with Abraham and Isaac and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven, while the heirs of the kingdom will be thrown into the outer darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. And to the centurion Jesus said, go, let it be done for you according to your faith. And the servant was healed in that hour. This is the word of the Lord.
Let's just go to God in prayer. Be with us this day, O Lord, as we do your work, and help us to live that work each and every day. Amen. Today in our Bible story, a military man asks Jesus to heal someone that is important to him. And Jesus, so moved by the man's faith, heals the sick person from afar. This is a nice story, but I have often wondered why it's in the Bible. Why is this particular story so important? Jesus healed many a person, and this is not the only time he healed without being in a person's presence. So what makes this one so significant? Jesus was approached by lots of different people with many requests made of him. Why did this particular individual grab his attention? Jesus made note more than once regarding someone's faith. Why did they speech and praise over this man? The importance of the story is in the character of the man and the exchange between him and Jesus. His contemporaries, the people that saw the centurion approach Jesus that day, would have seen a commander in the army, a man whose orders were followed without question, a Roman soldier who would have been treated poorly by the average citizen, a man who would have been feared by the Jewish nation, a Gentile who came on his own to speak with Christ. And Jesus that day saw something else, something that made this individual different, atypical, something worthy of praise. So what was it about the centurion that made Jesus take notice? Well, there are three things about this man worth addressing. First, this particular centurion was a good person. The centurions were the backbone of the Roman army. Here's how it worked. In the Roman legion, there were 6,000 men divided into 6 centuries, and each century had 100 men, and the centurion was in charge of each century. In his description of the Roman army, Olivius, who was a Greek historian who lived around 200 BC, he describes what a centurion should be. He says, they must not be so much venturesome seekers after danger as those who can command, steady in action, and reliable. They ought not to be over anxious to rush into a fight, but when pressed, they must be ready to hold their ground and die at their posts. They were the finest men in the Roman army. The centurion was good in that he was excellent at what he did. He was disciplined in body, mind, and spirit. He was well trained. He was respected by the military as a leader, a man among men, and he had a strong sense of character. The centurions in Scripture are mentioned because of the good things that they did. Barclay makes this point in his commentary on Matthew. He says,
It is interesting to note that every centurion listed in the New Testament is mentioned as a good and honorable person. There was a centurion who recognized Jesus on the cross as the Son of God. There was Cornelius, the first Gentile convert to the Christian church. There was the centurion who discovered that Paul was a Roman citizen and rescued him from the rioting mob. There was the centurion who was informed that the Jewish people had planned to murder Paul, and he took steps to foil that plan. There was the centurion whom Felix ordered to look after Paul. There was a centurion who went with Paul on his last journey to Rome, who treated him with every courtesy, and who accepted him as a leader when the storm struck their ship. The centurion in our story was good because of who he was, how he lived, the way his body and mind worked together, the way he respected and treated those he led, and those whom he sent. Next, we learn that the centurion was a loving man. He went to great lengths to see Jesus on someone else's behalf. To seek out God, to ask for help, to plead for a miracle is a great thing to do. But to do that for another is truly an act of selfless love. And the centurion didn't do this for his father or his brother or his child. This loving act was done for his servant. Now, this next bit where I'm talking about servant and slave, this is difficult for me because the centurion had a servant. I even hate to say the word slave nowadays. It's just a difficult thing. I have a real issue with the notion of one human being being able to own, abuse, and mistreat another human being. But at this point in Roman history, the Roman law defined a slave as a living tool, not a person, but a thing. And as such, they had no rights, and they were counted as inventory of all the other tools at the master's disposal. To consider any other human being as unequal or inferior to ourselves, in my opinion, is reprehensible. And even the notion turns my stomach. It is an indecency that we should ever fight against. Because how can we love our neighbor? How can we love ourselves? How can we love one another? How can we love God with our heart, mind, and soul if we see other human beings as anything less than our equals? The bright spot here in this passage is that in the eyes of the centurion, we cannot. He seems to be in agreement with me. For he treated his servant well by showing him love as a fellow human being. He respected his servant as an individual going to all lengths to save him from illness and death. He loved him and went outside of the acceptable norms of society to do what he considered was the right thing. It reminds me of how God treats us. No matter who we are or how we live, the mistakes we make, the way society considers us, the number of times we continue to get it wrong. We are given God's love. And God's love is that kind, compassionate, altruistic, noble, non-judgmental, never goes away, benevolent, pure kind of love. This is what the centurion did for his servant. This is how God loves us. God knows us for who we are and loves us because we are worthy to be loved. Finally, the centurion demonstrates that he was a man of faith. We see this faith in a few ways. First, as a Gentile, a Roman soldier, the centurion had great respect for the Jewish religion. He told Jesus that he was not worthy to have God's Son come into his house. And that's because according to Jewish law, a Jewish person was not allowed to set foot in the house of a Gentile, for that dwelling would be unclean. By his faith, the centurion had showed great respect for the Jewish people and their God. Second, he knew Jesus. He believed in his power. He knew the things he could do. He approached him in humility. He recognized him as Emmanuel, God with us. Third, the centurion centurion did not allow any barriers to stand in the way of his faith. He could have used his power, his position, to try and force Jesus' hand, but he didn't. He sought the Lord in humbleness, and he opened his heart to him. His faith was evident because he had total trust in Jesus as the Son of God. So I think this story is important. I think it's amazing. I think it's wonderful. It teaches us as followers of Christ to be good and loving and faith-filled people. But then my question is that enough? A good person can be a law-abiding citizen, someone who does no harm, a helper who makes this world a better place. It doesn't mean they have a relationship with the living Christ. A loving person can put others first, can forgive those that cause pain and hurt, can live selflessly. It doesn't mean the Holy Spirit dwells within them. A faith-filled individual can be very spiritual. They can believe that God is working things out for good. They can trust that evil will never win out over goodness. Doesn't mean they are living out God's plan for their lives. Jesus begins to address this in verse 10. He says, "In no one in Israel have I seen such faith. I tell you, many will come from east and west. They will eat with Abraham and Isaac and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven, while the heirs of the kingdom will be thrown out into darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth." Being good and loving and faithful is a journey. It begins with God's grace given in Christ. It continues as we live and try and strive each day with Christ's presence within us. Now, I don't know if you've ever read Outside Magazine. It's for adventures of people and things you do outdoors. And occasionally in Outside Magazine, they will put stories of people that do these crazy, death-defying stunts. I don't really know why people do these things. I don't know if hypnotists are to leave their mark or what may have you. But I'm going to share with you three very brief stories of people that have done these stunts. And I have seen it in Outside Magazine. I have Googled it, so it has to be correct. So here are the three stories. The first is a Frenchman named Jean-Luc. I always want to say Picard when I say Jean-Luc. Jean-Luc Antoine. And in 1987, he set a world ski record for skiing down a mountain of rocks. Why you would do that is beyond me. Tammy found a very nice picture. But he skied down rocks, which I guess is brave and good enough. But the problem with skiing down a mountain of rocks is, and we all know this, there's no braking system on skis, right? I mean, the proper skier knows how to turn their body and turn their skis a certain way into the snow, and that's how they stop. I don't think they're pulling anything on the skis. So you can't do that on rocks. So what this man did is he built a wall of cardboard boxes, over 18,000 of them. And when he got down to the bottom of the mountain after setting the world speed record, he stopped and saved his life by crashing into the 18,000 cardboard boxes. The second man is a man from Austria, and his name is Felix Baumgartner. And he is famous for being a daredevil and a base jumper and a skydiver. And he set 8 world records when he climbed inside a helium-sized weather balloon and skydived from the stratosphere. He actually skydived from the stratosphere to the Earth 24 miles. He ended up in New Mexico. Nobody even knew where he was going to land. He ended up in New Mexico. He went at speeds of 843 miles per hour as he plummeted down towards the Earth. They didn't know it at the time, but he had actually helped scientists, and he actually gathered scientific information that helped the world and the way we live, because they didn't know it at the time. He went at such a velocity that he broke the sound barrier. And in fact, he was the first man to ever break the sound barrier without using any kind of vehicle to make that happen. And when he landed and everything was safe and they interviewed him, he said that he was very glad, very happy that he had helped science and helped further scientific discoveries. But he said, if I'm honest, I didn't care a thing about that. I just wanted to end up alive. Now, my favorite is Larry Walters. Larry Walters had a dream in his life. He wanted to be able to fly. He grew up, he joined the army, he went to Vietnam so that he could do his part. But he had poor eyesight and he failed the test. He served his country, but not as a pilot. And he always wanted to fly. So one day, Larry Walters had an idea. He decided this was the plan. He would get 48 weather balloons and fill them with helium. He would attach them to a lawn chair with a helium tank. And the plan was to go about 30, 40, 50 feet in the air, tether himself, eat his favorite sandwich and drink his favorite beer, and then pull himself back down to the ground. 48 weather balloons filled with helium is a lot of balloons. And when he let go of the one rope to tether himself down, there was such a velocity that he broke the tether and he went up, up, up in the air. 16,000 feet. Now, Larry Walters had a problem. How does he get down? What does he do? Well, he happened to have a pellet gun with him, and he systematically shot those balloons one at a time until he got close enough to the air. This became world famous news because there was a TWA pilot coming in for a landing, and he saw a man in a lawn chair attached to 48 weather balloons. And when Larry hit the ground and arrived safely, he was greeted by the ambulances, the fire trucks, and the police. And everything seemed to turn out fine. So why do people do this? Is it to become famous or infamous? Is it so that you can see the picture of the National Enquirer when you're in the line at the supermarket? Is it to leave their mark? Is this the way they make the world a better place? So then the question becomes, how are all of us going to leave our mark? How do we make this world a better place? What are people going to think of us when we're long gone? Are we going to be the one that crashed into 18,000 cardboard boxes? Are we going to be that person that was nice and friendly and went to work and helped each other and went to church on Sundays? How are we going to do that with our lives? How are we going to be transformed to do God's work? You know, I haven't talked about it directly. It's been reading between the lines today, but today is Transfiguration Sunday, that day where Jesus went up into the mountain with three of his disciples, and he was transfigured in dazzling white, and he was talking to Moses and Elijah, and he was transformed that day, changed that day, as were the three that were with him, forever changed. How are we going to be changed and transformed for God? Are we going to do it by being good, which means are we going to love God with all of our heart, mind, soul, and strength? Are we going to do it by being good and loving, meaning that Jesus comes first, others come second, and our needs comes way down the list? Are we going to do it by being good and loving and faithful, meaning give wholeheartedly all of ourselves to God to put that trust in God, so God can do amazing things through us, so that when we leave our mark in this world, it is for God's glory. Let us pray. Dear God, as we go forth from here, may we go forth as people who do your work, filled with love, filled with goodness, filled with your faith, now and always. Amen. Thank you. God's love, God's peace, and God's power. Amen.